Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Purdy Insurance. Visit Purdy Insurance on Market Street in Sunbury or visit online at purdyinsurance.com. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
As pick just...
All right, great to have you with us on the show. Brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, life, business, boat, motorcycle, whatever the insurance needs may be. Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. The best in the business. The best. No getting around. The best. And, that's why you go with the best. And we're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. Online at sunburymotors.com. Time now for our play-by-play call of the day. Yeah.
Now, these are two huge free throws. Misses them both. Treasure Hunt with the basketball. Back to Massengill. Dre Edwards, top of the key with the three!
South Carolina doesn't have a timeout.
4.2 seconds. South Carolina with a prayer. Big Blue Madness in March. They've waited 40 years. The SEC tournament.
They'll both make the NCAAs. All right, so, but it's still important. South Carolina came in ranked number one. So, okay, that's our play-by-play call of the day. Let's get to the Calvin Ridley story. Ridley missed most of the 21 season. And now he's not going to play in 22 at all because he's been suspended indefinitely for betting on games. He had stepped away from the Falcons during the season in order to deal with mental health issues. Okay. The league's announcement said that his betting took place while he was away from the team, and there is no evidence that he used any inside information to facilitate his wagers. There's also no evidence that anyone from the Falcons or any other team was aware that he was doing this. Roger Goodell said there's nothing more fundamental to the NFL success and to the reputation of everyone associated with our league than upholding the integrity of the game. This is the responsibility of every coach, player, owner, game official, and anyone else employed by the league. Your actions put the integrity of the game at risk, threaten to damage public confidence in professional football, and potentially undermine the reputations of your fellow players throughout the league. For decades, gambling on NFL games has been considered among the most significant violations of league policy, warranting the most substantial sanction. But it's okay for us to take the money. No, I'm just kidding. In your case, I acknowledge and commend you for promptly reporting for an interview and admitting to your actions. He's eligible to return on February 15th next year. I mean, that's the concern. That's a huge concern. There's no getting around it. Huge concern. And that's why that's why, for example, you've got the, constantly be aware of that. I mean, even when the days, Paul Hornung and Alex Karras were suspended. They, you know, but they bet on their own team. You know, and then of course Pete Rose, he bet on his own team. But again, you know, what's that moment where they find out that you're gambling, you fall behind, and they ask you to do something else? That's why you got to worry about it. And for Pete Rose, I've said this once, I've said it a thousand times. When he was gambling as the manager, right? Part of your job is to not only manage the situation, manage the game, but also you have to manage the season. So say, for example, I've used Matt Catrillo, my ace relief pitcher, which shows you what kind of organization we have. But
get the lingerie on the deck. Call the janitor.
I would agree.
And I've used him three straight days, but it turns out today I put money on the game. Now, I should not be using Matt here on the fourth straight day. Should not be. It's not good for him. And also, long term, it's not going to be good for our season because I want to make sure I still have Matt available to be strong and able to pitch for us in August. But you know what? I put money on today's game. Now, I bet on us to win. But then I do something I shouldn't do if I was actually managing the game with a clear head. Without my money on the line, I put him in the game. Even though it would be best for him and overall best for the team and best for the season if he's held out today, because long term it's a 162 game schedule. And what if he comes out of it and he's like, "Geez, I know we won the thing. It's great, but boy, man, my arm just feels dead." And all of a sudden, he's on the disabled list for 21 days because I didn't manage it right. And I didn't manage it right because I pitched him and shouldn't have. That's when you, it's whenever you hear people argue, well, he bet on his own team. I'm like, no, that's not the reason for it. Okay, it's not the cut and dried reason for it. Believe me, you can suddenly out there misuse your people because you have money on the game, and guess what? Yeah, you're gonna lose. You might lose some games down the road. And may have hurt a career in the process. But the but he's gone for the upcoming season, and obviously in no way, shape, or form does it help the Atlanta Falcons. But I would like to point out that there's really almost nobody here that cares about the Falcons.
Correct. And nobody in Atlanta really cares. Oh, I'm sorry.
They aren't real fans.
They're not. Falcon fans are not real fans. I'm sorry. They're not.
Hey, I mean, you know where the real fans are?
Where's that?
Oh, in Philadelphia, where they're honest.
You're dang right they are.
Right. And nobody wants to go play there. All right, so...
At least we show up to games, even when our team stinks.
I'd back off on that statement. I was talking to somebody.
When it comes to football, we do. Other sports, okay.
I was talking to somebody. They went to a Flyers game.
Yeah.
And they said it was unbelievable.
It is.
I'll be honest with you. In my lifetime, I would never have thought that there'd be an empty seat at a Flyers game. Because Flyers fans have been loyal to the core, showing up all the time for decades.
Yes.
And I guess it was like not just a few, it was a lot of empty seats.
Oh, yeah, it's bad. It's like not even hitting 5,000 total right now.
That's shocking to me. It's sad.
It's sad, but I'm not surprised with the way things have gone with the organization. I can't even tell you the last game I even watched, to be honest with you. I have no interest to watch the Flyers at all. I really don't. Last game I watched was Flyers-Pens, and that was only for a couple of periods because the Pens were pulling away. Like, the Flyers, they're not interesting to watch, and there's so many things wrong with this organization that doesn't make you want to watch right now.
Fortunately, James Harden's in Philadelphia to save it all.
Partially, yeah. I mean, the Sixers were fun to begin with, but he's made it more fun, definitely. I mean,
how'd they do against the Bucks? Oh, they haven't played him yet. Oh. Celtics? No, they haven't played them either. But I'll give you credit. You're better than the Knicks.
They did come back and beat the Cavs at home on Friday night. Now, Saturday night against Miami was not fun at all, but guess what? There was no James Harden either. And it was a back-to-back.
What's his problem now?
No, it's the Sixers are man. Or it was his hamstring management. I guess they put this plan together of how many games they were going to let him play or whatever, and that was one of them.
God,
yeah, it was mostly load. It was essentially load management, but in the Sixers' defense, it looked like he did tweak his hamstring. Something didn't look right during the second half of the Cleveland game, and I think that might have scared him as well, coming and playing the back-to-back. But it was very disappointing to not see him play in that game, because that was the biggest game to date. But you got the Bulls tonight, and hopefully Harden should be back in. But yeah, that was a little frustrating on Saturday. But it looked like he did tweak something. Like, he didn't look right in the second half, even though he was still phenomenal.
I tell you right now, the NBA leads the league, and I feel like I have a twinge.
You're right.
Come on.
I know. Yeah, it was frustrating.
After a while, it's... You know what? You know what really strikes me about this? Okay? Is that you do have a generation of people out there that think this is the greatest idea going. Like, oh yeah, I'll get ready for the playoffs. The whole thing. It's like, that's not what this is about. Right? You are a fan-based, customer-based business. That's what you are. Right? This is not about, okay? You can't become so corporate as an entity. This is sports, right? I go through a basketball season. John Harrah's out there every game, busting his backside. Jalen Pickett is 12th in the nation in minutes, percentage of minutes played for his team, 12th in the whole nation, right? In college basketball, nobody sits out unless they are actually hurt. Now, it's not 82 games, right? It's 32 games at a minimum. But it's 82 games at a minimum, 32 in the other. Which college basketball players sit out? Any of the Bucknell guys consider sitting out? Nathan, think about, you know, I think I'm not going to play whomever tonight. You never hear of college basketball? No. Right? You play every game. And they're not getting $10 to $30 million a year to do this. These guys are playing a sport. Okay? They're playing a game. And part of the business is showing up. I talk about that family of four, like the 1-2 games they're going to go to a year. Okay, you keep pulling this stuff, and they're going to sit there and like, you know what? I had a friend of mine go to the Magic Pacers game last week because he was down in Florida. Magic's Pacers, okay? You know what? He texted me he was going to the game. You know what the second text read? Really cool. No load management. They're all playing tonight. This is great. That was the second thing he texted me. Where's the obligation to people? Where's the obligation? I mean, to be honest with you, let's talk about this for a moment. Matt's got a game tonight with Bucknell, right? You got a game at 6, right?
Yep, women playoff game tonight against Lehigh.
Yeah, so Clappy the Clown will be in the final half hour. And so...
Correct.
Right, so...
S-U-I-T, that spells Suda!
That was actually a pretty good one. he's rolling his eyes, I'm sure. All right. Now, Matt could have taken off the show today because he has this tonight. What's Matt doing? Matt's doing the show. It's an obligation on his part to do the show. Now, every once in a while, he's got to leave early, and Tony fills in, or every once in a while, he has to leave early, and tonight, Kevin will be in. To be honest with you, do you know how many other Big Ten announcers have said to me they are shocked that I do the show on the day of the game? How about, like, all of them? But my obligation is, you know, I made an agreement with Roger to do the show. So tomorrow I'll do the show, and then I got to travel. All right. Wednesday I'll do the show from Indy. And if Penn State wins, I'll do the show from Indy on Thursday as well. You know, I could go over to Gainbridge if I want, take in the games during the course of the day and things like that. No. Obligations to do this. Okay? Because that's what's expected. Now, you know, you, the audience, can tune in and out. Based on what we're understanding, they're mostly tuning in. We've had some pretty strong looks here along the way, which is pretty cool. But, these guys, for some reason... Somebody's got in there. Well, this is the way to do it. Load management and analyze. Hey, I'm sorry. That family of four up there showed up to watch you play hoop tonight. And now James Harden plays 3 games. Like, I can't play tonight. You can't play tonight. You can't play tonight? How many days were you off before you played the 3 games? Ben Simmons, I'm not ready to play. Why aren't you ready to play?
Well, he's a whole different story.
But I'm saying, excuse me. How many games has Harden been out? How many games was he out before he joined Philadelphia?
No, he was out quite a bit. You're right.
Yeah, he did not join Philadelphia and play the first day he was, he was traded. His big debut is coming up. For God's sakes, play now. Let's go. I mean, come on. I mean, if somebody's hurt, they're hurt. I got it. If they're injured, I got it. Okay? But I need a break. A break from what? You play a game. The guy plays 1 game in Philadelphia, can't take it, and that's it. Yeah, your fans kill everything.
You speak to James, he feels just quite on the contrary.
Hasn't lost a game there yet, buddy boy. Wait till that happens. we're real here. Ben Simmons, I might make the trip, but I'm not going to play. Yeah. How can you not play? You haven't been doing anything, right? You didn't keep yourself in shape?
You want to know why? Because he's a coward. That's why.
But he hasn't played yet at all, even at home.
Exactly.
You have to be, we've got to be able to do what? Do what? You're not bringing him back from Tommy John surgery.
Apparently had another setback with his back. And this is great because all I can do is just laugh at the Nets, and it's great.
Your guy didn't play against Cleveland. I don't want to hear about you laughing. He didn't play.
Yeah, but the thing with Ben Simmons has been out there for a while. I mean, I know James Harden's has his issues too with that, but what Ben Simmons has been doing is... nowhere near what's going on with James Harden.
I'm just saying, where is the obligation to the fans?
But you're right. I've always said this. Player says one thing, you know, whatever. But when it comes to you're the team, you're the manager, if a guy's healthy enough to play, he plays. If he doesn't, he doesn't. We don't need to complicate this anymore.
If you're hurt, I got it. If you're injured, boy, do I absolutely have it. So I got it. But for goodness sakes, do you know how many guys that I see for Penn State football and Penn State basketball that battle their guts out all season long? They're all sore and hurt at the end of the year. They all are. But you don't think Jalen Pickett's not sore and hurt? I mean, you don't think Geo Baker and Ron Harper for Rutgers aren't sore and hurt? Of course they are. They've gone through practices, games. John Hara. My goodness, E.J. Liddell, Jaden Ivey. These guys have been putting out performance after performance. They're banged up, hurt, they're sore, and they're showing up every single game. Penn State football, I can tell you the guys that, like, you know, drag themselves out there on a practice because, you know what, we got a game this week.
You got more to give, Steve Jones.
I got 1186 coming up on Wednesday, buddy boy. Make it 1187, all right? double would help. You got more to give, John Hara. All right, back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When car repairs get difficult.
Well, I just don't know.
Me neither.
We get good. Sunbury Motors. More than quality new and used cars, Sunbury Motors specializes in complicated auto repair diagnosis. They can handle intricate repairs and even complete auto body with service open Monday through Friday, 7 till 4. And Sunbury Motors has made simple repairs easy. Maintaining your vehicle is necessary. Finding the time to do it is difficult. Welcome to Sunbury Motors Quick Lane. Open 7 till 4, Monday through Friday. Just walk in or call ahead. Relax in their remodeled waiting room with Wi-Fi, beverages, and snacks. Will Sunbury Motors factory trained techs take care of your oil change, tire alignments, brakes, and inspections. Quick Lane, 6:30 to 6, Monday through Friday, Saturday, 6:30 till 2. Sunbury Motors, Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury. And Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We take the out of auto repair.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Show has taken a dramatic downturn. We apologize in advance. Today's show brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, life, business, boat, motorcycle, whatever it may be. You want the best in the business taking care of your business. That's Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. We're in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. Online at sunburymotors.com. I feel like Buller's the dog set the tone for the show when Michelle told him he's coming into work today. Your name was brought up, he growled.
No, he loves me because I feed him treats all the time.
Pictures speak a thousand words, my friend. It was not a friendly look from that beautiful little dog.
So I got a question for you. You're in a situation right now where when and you continue on. How does that work with the hotel? Do you have to go down every night going, yeah, I'm going to stay one more night? Yeah, I'm going to stay one more night? Because you had that problem a few years ago.
That's fine. You don't even think about it. You just go down and check out when you're ready to check out.
But they had a run a few years ago where they
went to the championship game.
But
yeah.
But did they come then from?
Then the same thing happened 4 years ago in New York.
Yeah,
and we stayed at Essex House, man. I racked up some big time Marriott points on that trip, man. You go Essex House. Listen to this. You go okay Essex House, 4 nights. Okay. I mean, not exactly at team rates. Then we played at Notre Dame, and we stayed at a Courtyard. Then we went to Milwaukee, and we stayed at a Westin. So these are all in the Marriott group. And then it's always at the Marriott Marquis for the NIT Final Four. Dick and I are looking at it like, hey, I got some free trips out of that one. So I was like, hey.
Winning.
So how does it work? You just literally go down the day you're leaving and check out.
Now, did they come from the pigtail bracket those two times that we were talking about earlier?
No.
Okay.
No. Penn State, when they went in, they opened up at Madison Square Garden, opened up Thursday, beat Northwestern. Northwestern had to win the night before. I think Northwestern beat Illinois, I think. Illinois or Iowa, one of the two. And Penn State then beat Northwestern. Then the bus got hit by a car going into the quarterfinals to play Ohio State. Not only got hit once by the car, got hit twice by the car. Then the guy in the car, okay, is so incensed he pulls into the security area at Madison Square Garden, mind you, in New York City, of all places. Needless to say, he became familiar face down with the pavement. Our bus driver, meanwhile, wanted to get out of the bus and wanted to tear him apart, but held off. And I think we're going in like, oh, this is. I was on the left side of the bus, and this is where it happened. We're pulling on to, I want to say it was 8th? Yeah, we're pulling on to 8th. So we're making a right turn onto 8th in back of the garden, right? And guy pulls up and goes, boom. I looked over. I said, we just got hit. They go, what? I said, we just got hit by a car. They said, you're kidding me. And then the guy goes up and he cuts the bus and he hits the bus again. Like, and then he pulls into the lot. And of course, you can't do that.
It's like a NASCAR race.
It's a security area, right? And we kind of walk in. We're all looking over. I said, well, that was a little bizarre. I looked at Dick. I said, well, I guess we got the opening to the show. This will be great. And that was the one where Penn State won it. At the end. Let me see here. I think I've got it here somewhere. I mean, it was quite the ending, as a matter of fact. That would be 2018. Let's see. It was the third time they beat Ohio State that year, too. Okay, 19. Oh, we played Campbell that year? Ooh, that'd be a bad game. I forgot they even played him. Like, I remember so many games in my career. Then you go back and you go, ooh, they played Campbell. Oh, really? That'd be horrible. Funny, see, like they played Montana. I remember that game like it was yesterday. Oh, let's see. Where is it? Okay. Penn State, Ohio State, Big Ten. Okay. Yeah. So this is the night we get hit by the bus. Okay. So this is the night we get hit by the bus. Hold on a second here. Let me make sure I get the right thing here. All right. Now this is fun.
Here wing Andre Wesson. Bates Diop looks at the clock with 8. Bates Diop drives on Garner. He spins. Lost it. Got it back. Lost it. Garner to the floor. Garner needs to get the ball to Boren and does. Penn State looks to win it now with 14 seconds to go.
No timeouts. Get it up in the air.
10 seconds left. Dockage on Carr. Carr looks at it. Crossover. Drives. Backdoor Reeves. Slam dunk Penn State with 2.8 to go.
That's how that one ended.
That's always nice when you get one like that.
Right. Then went back, and then they had to play Purdue the next day. And the Purdue game, it's the semifinal game on Saturday afternoon. It was the late game. And Michigan played Michigan State in the first game. Really good game. Okay. And Purdue, this is going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Carson Edwards is playing really well. Shep Garner is playing great. And Pat got a T. And Paul Sells called the T on him. And it's like, you know, I have a lot of respect for Paul as an official. I really do. And But there are moments where you should and should not, and that was one of those moments you should not. Just, okay, calm them down. It's a big moment in the game, and it kind of swung the game. And, you know, but yeah, you just go down to the front desk when it's over with and go,
yeah,
I'm checking out.
All right,
see you.
It's kind of like Groundhog Day. You can check out today. Say.
No. The hotel knows if you're winning. I mean, the hotel is aware you're winning.
The only problem with this particular tournament, and especially coming where Penn State's coming from, and even when they made those runs, is by the time Saturday comes, the legs are got to be jello.
Oh, sure they are. No, it is for everybody. It is for everybody. That's why you want the bye so badly. I mean, and that's why everybody wants the bye so badly. You're trying to keep the attrition rate down, especially if you don't play a lot of people. I mean, you know, Penn State plays a few people. Minnesota, for example, doesn't. Minnesota plays essentially seven. You know, but it's the first game now. You know, both teams have to stay on the road. So, I mean, Penn State came back here. Minnesota went back home. I mean, you're not allowed to go until tomorrow anyway. You're not, in other words, Minnesota, Penn State could not go from Rutgers to Indianapolis. You're not allowed to. Minnesota is not allowed to go from Northwestern to Indianapolis. That both were under the rules, had to go home. And you're not allowed to go into the tournament till the night before or the day before. The day before. So, for example, the top four seeds, they get the double bye. They play Friday. They're not allowed to go till Thursday.
Is that because of practice opportunities? Or?
No, it's because of school.
I forgot about that part of it.
I mean, that's the reason. The reason is because of they don't want you to.
Oh, yeah.
Now, Penn State isn't in that boat this week. Penn State's on spring break. But, you know, you've got to keep the rules same for everybody. They're trying to make the tournament as much. For example, this tournament doesn't, you know, the Big Ten has never had a banquet. They've never, you know, all those things. Like, for example, the Big East has had, you know, pre-tournament banquets and the whole thing. When Penn State was in the Atlantic 10, they had a pre-tournament banquet. No, that doesn't happen with this. They're trying to treat it as much like the regular season as possible. So.
Yeah,
and
it
keeps your class, you know, you're trying to keep your class misses to a minimum. Although, for some odd reason, the NCAA tournament, that doesn't appear to be a concern. it's like you play on Thursday, you have to be there Tuesday. If you play Thursday in the NCAA tournament, you have to be there Tuesday because Wednesday's the open practice that's free to the fans.
I have always wondered this from the outside looking in, and you and I probably have talked about it over the years at some point or another, but why is it that the tournament gets the automatic bid and the winner of the league doesn't get an automatic bid?
Because I think that what they're trying to do is they're trying to give the tournament stakes. I think that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to give the tournament stakes. So they take the regular season, they make it seeding. Because it was the ACC that started all this. I mean, the reason you have multiple teams in the tournament now from conferences is that the ACC every year, like all conferences, only sent one. Well, you've got teams in the ACC. This is what Lefty Drizel, we're going to make Maryland the UCLA of the East. And they get in the tournament, and only one team got out of there. North Carolina would get out 1 year. NC State gets out 1 year. Duke gets out 1 year. Everybody else had to stay home. That's why in the 70s, you had the NIT, okay, and you had, for 1 year, it was called the Commissioner's Cup. And Indiana won it. And that was, you know, the conference champions, or not kind of, the Big Ten would have sent its Big Ten regular season champ. But schools that had great years did not qualify for the NCAAs. So then they finally changed it where they allowed conferences to get multiple teams, and they started expanding the field. And that, in turn, expanded the popularity of the tournament. But that's the way it used to be in the ACC, Kevin. I mean, the only team that got in was the conference tournament champion. You had teams went 25, 26 games, not in.
Yeah, I could see that. It always kind of bugged me, though, from, again, looking at it from the outside in, that there's a chance. Now, it doesn't usually happen with some of the bigger conferences, but there's a chance you could have a great year and then take a stumble in the tournament, and you don't get to go, even though you won the league. It's more of an issue in the mid-majors than it is, you know, in the power conferences.
Yeah. So when you look at Bob Knight was adamant he was against the Big Ten tournament. I, of course, was adamant on the other side, you need a conference tournament. And here was the reason why I felt the Big Ten needed a conference tournament. Now, and when I argued about this in the 90s, the Big Ten hit a rut where, Michigan and the Fab Five got to the championship game 2 years in a row, right? But nobody else was going anywhere in the Big Ten. They kept getting knocked out in the early rounds, and there was getting to be frustration about year after year, you know, the Big Ten champion gets in, can't get out of the first weekend. Right, you know, other Big Ten teams get in, can't get out of the first weekend. They go, what's wrong? And I say, guys, you need a tournament. And I said, because, you know, again, I had the experience of doing 9 years of the Atlantic 10 tournament. And I said, I'll tell you exactly what the tournament does. It actually makes you tournament ready. I mean, we just went through the Big Ten wrestling tournament. Now, I know all these guys have been through it before, and Aaron Brooks is the defending champion nationally and the Big Ten champion. Okay. But Aaron Brooks has now gone through the tournament in tournament fashion, and guess what? He's going to get a reprieve. He's going to get a second chance, and he's probably going to approach it differently than he did yesterday because he now knows he can lose. And that's what the tournament does. It gets you into a... hey, let's keep playing. It's one and done. Let's keep playing. One and done. When you're going into the final weekend of the regular season of the Big Ten, and in what, 93, 94, 95, 93, 94, 95, 96, the first 4 years I'm in the Big Ten, first 4 years I'm in, the regular season, that was it. You were done. And the Big Ten just on the, you know, so in other words, this Sunday coming up would have been the last game of the regular season for the Big Ten. And that's it. We're done. You know, Saturday, Sunday, you're done. And now the NCAAs, now you go into tournament mode. The Big Ten tournament, I felt, changed everything around for the Big Ten in terms of its ability to get multiple teams deeper into the tournament because now you are mentally into a one-and-done mentality a week before the NCAA tournament began. And that's why I think you've seen so many Big Ten teams advance to the Final Four. Wisconsin's been there. Michigan State's been there. Michigan has been there. Illinois has been there. You know, on and on you go with the, you know, with the teams that have been there. And I think they've made deep runs in the tournament. Ever since they put the Big Ten tournament in, you've seen deep runs by teams of the Big Ten. Because I think it allows you to kick into that one-and-done mentality 1 week sooner, so that you're not taken aback when you're actually put into that atmosphere. We will take a break. Matt is out looking for James Harden right now as we continue on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
In an ever-changing world, one thing you can always count on is the service at Purdy Insurance. Hi, this is Season. While the world is constantly changing, Purdy Insurance is dedicated to providing you with the highest level of service to protect you, your family, and your business. Give us a call today at 570-286-5855. Go to our website at purdyinsurance.com or check us out on Facebook to see what Purdy Insurance can do for you.
It's load management. He feels a twinge. The NBA has more guys get twinges than any league on the planet. What's the load management like in Premier League soccer? Oh, there isn't any. Yeah. NHL? No. College sports? No. Now, baseball's 162 games. I mean, you can't play, you know, every game. The NFL doesn't even do load management. Like, at the last week of the season, they debate whether to play guys or not. But the other weeks, they're not debating it. So. For some reason, maybe this has been since the beginning of time. With sports, does anybody sit there and think about the fans? Fans are the ones that put in so much commitment to be there. It's unbelievable. And I'm driving on the turnpike Saturday. I had to go down to Dick Girardi's house, so I had to take the turnpike. I had to stop at Dick's house first before I went over to the hotel. I'm on the turnpike, and I think I saw Thursday, 389. That sound right to you?
Yeah, that was about right.
I'm on the turnpike, right? I get to Bowmansville, and the light comes on. I said, I better gas up now. It's either there or Valley Forge is one of the two. So I pick Bowmansville. 411. I'm like, yeah. 411.
Problem was, it was 389 before you got there, about 15 minutes earlier.
Well, no, I'm driving back yesterday, and I went back. I get to Clark's Ferry, and it was the best price out there. It was $4.19.
I was going to say $4.39, but yeah.
It went up 8 cents in one day.
I've seen it go up 15 cents on the strip in 15 minutes.
Yeah, but that's a different story and a part of your life we shouldn't talk about.
Have a great call, bud.
Yeah. Give Bullers a big hug for me, will you?
You got it.
He's gone through a lot, and he's an awesome dog. So, all right, my man. Be good. It's always fun to spend any time with you. You know that.
I love you, brother. Take care.
You too, man. Thanks. All right. Back tomorrow. Looking forward to it.